And now it is time for your headliner. You guys ready for your headliner? I need a little more. You guys ready for your headliner? This guy is a legend in the comedy scene and in the convention scene. Oh, I'm just going to build you up like huge. This guy is a god among men. He's got a gigantic penis. He's amazing. He's dashingly handsome. He's one of my favorite people on this planet. Please give it up for Uncle Yo.
Wow. Shit. No, I can't live up to that. Good night, America. Goodbye. Goodbye forever. Goodbye forever. Thank you guys so much for your fucking patience staying out here. After the guy 2 guys ago, this is an 18-plus show. I'm sorry. It's MAGFest. We're doing this. Y'all know you can drink before MAGFest, right? Before MAGLAFs. Y'all know you can drink during MAGFest, right? Who is at MAGFest to drink? A show of fucking hands? This is not KatsuCon. Who's here to drink? Woo! Who's here for some games? Woo! Who recently bit somebody? Yeah! What the fuck, really? All right, so Pokemon Go came out. I kind of want to investigate that. Was that... was that like a knee-jerk reaction? Like, let me see some ID. No, go away! Or was it like a buildup? Like, is that childhood guilt finally building up? It's just always been there on the surface. Someone is eventually just gonna catch me off guard and I'm just gonna let the horrible secret out. I like biting people. You realize a cannibal could go on an all-vegan diet. When Pokemon Go came out last year, and everyone would help and applaud that. It's okay, because vegans are scrawny and can't really defend themselves. It's fine, they have no hit points, it's great. It's a horrible thing to say. Hug a vegan, if you know one. Hug one, because self-righteousness is a terrible insulator. It's, all right, that's a horrible thing to say to them. But I feel like if I ever had a child learned how to spawn, Noah, is this your phone? Not anymore. It's all right. He almost officiated my wedding. This is an okay thing to do. I don't know where my wife is. I'll probably find her at the end of the show, divorce court. So give it time. Just for about 3 months. So we're just about done. But I just feel like if I had a kid, I would be more comfortable if he came out gay to me than vegan. Because queer, that's something you got. You got to build up, fight the rest of your life. Vegan is a choice you inflict on everyone who you'll ever take out to a restaurant. Have you taken a vegan out to eat? It's like taking an atheist anywhere. It's horrible. It's aggravating. They are bothersome human beings. Canada, North America's Hufflepuff. They're just happy to be a part of it and show up. That's the greatest lie. That's the greatest magic, is to believe you're something other than a damn Hufflepuff. Delaware, the Hufflepuff state. You'll visit us eventually. The tide. Bye, everybody. It's been fun. It's getting really high up this year. We are all nerd comedians. We are all nerds this weekend at MAGFest. And after 8 years in the con circuit, I'm so happy that this is my first ever MAGFest, my first ever time getting out here. And I'm so stoked for it, because normally nerds and comedians, we just get paid an exposure, which, if you've ever watched the Discovery Channel, that's the only thing that can kill white people. Someone just rock climbing up there, just gonna show how granola I am. Dude, I didn't even know how to finish that sentence. That's how unathletic I am. Noah and I are both at that weird stage of white where we're somehow scrawny and pudgy at the same time. Like, someone just had a pipe cleaner, tried to put on some Silly Putty, but it's all just kind of melting off to go with anyway. We started off the evening so well. We had, like, an Asian dude. We had a black guy. Then nothing but white guys in glasses. This whole night at Mags Labs has been the Doctor Strange film, and I apologize for that. Not enough of you saw the Doctor Strange movie to get that. I do not apologize for that. Like, most of you out there in my generation, on that border of Generation X or Millennials, there are two consistent fears as people who play video games should always have. One is that we will never see another good Sonic the Hedgehog game in our lifetime. I'm not talking a Smash Brothers game. Those are great Sonic games. I'm saying like a solid, good Sonic the Hedgehog game. And the second fear you should all have is to one day, the same fear I have, to one day inherit my father's colon. You should all have that fear that you will someday inherit my father's colon. It is a wrecking ball waiting to happen. Because when your parents get together, your genetic code becomes a game of Plinko. And sometimes you get your mom's immune system, or your dad's bipolar, or you get your mom's bipolar and your dad's immune system. It's a giant crapshoot of where it's going to go. Last year, I took my parents on a double date to meet my now wife's parents. It was so adorable. Teaching 50-year-olds how to play Tinder. I'm just kidding, they're 55. So. They'll get to it, and my father has his coffee, gets up to use the facilities. My mother immediately goes wide-eyed and runs to the facilities to protect the legacy. And I ask her, how long have you done this to clean up after him? I've been the hazmat team your whole life, son. We never wanted to tell you this. I should probably know, because that's probably my future, you idiots. He is thrice divorced, and I know at this point he's not going to just hook up with another woman. All my father wants, I think, is a growler filled with Miller High Life that can quote John Wayne movies and World War II documentaries back at him. That'll make him happy. But my it's just he goes off to the restroom, and I don't think anyone is ever ready for his jelly, because I don't understand what he does, because he'll do it to my sister's house too. He'll destroy my sister's bathroom. And the only way I can understand of how he's able to take before and after photo, this is me at the start of 2016, this is the bathroom after 2016, after my father arrives on it. As far as I can understand, his asshole must be like halfway up his back, must be in the wrong place. Or maybe he squats in the sink and goes over that, which I know he can't do because of his knees, because I have them too. Or maybe he has like the hippo tail that just flaps it, spreads it everywhere, like a weed whacker, like he's seeding grass of the yarn. Or maybe he just learned to twerk last year. I don't know what this is. My going theory of how my father shits. I do talk about video games eventually. Give it a time. We're loading. This is the load screen for this bad boy. I assume he must have fingers like a gecko, crawl up to the ceiling, and weed whacker, and continues the twerk. Because entering a public restroom after my father, it's not even like a Jackson Pollock. It's a postmodern version of Picasso's Guernica. Because you see Guernica and you first think, oh, this is hilarious. Take a closer look. Oh my God. What happened? Then you learn the origin story. What led to this amazing photo? This is horrifying. And then you learn he did it all in one night. Mankind is monstrous. We're all just beasts hiding behind legends and words and language and flesh and clothing. We are the monsters. And that'll be my future in another 10 years. Looking forward to that new Sonic the Hedgehog game. Moved in with my fiance so she could be my wife also, because Uber's fucking expensive. And I am comfortably a cat dad, which is another word for loser. I think for millennials, like 40 is gonna be the new 18, because that's when you finally move out of the house. We got our one black cat. And I will not say that cats are better pets than dogs. And I'll also not say that dogs are better pets than cats. They're both critical to grow up with, have something to just shake, something furry. They're a great member of the family. But I will say, cat people are better than dog people, because I have never stepped in cat shit on the fucking subway, fucking sidewalk. I don't know how it even got into the subway. It's also, cat people don't use public picnics as an excuse to bring their fucking cat to every barbecue. We're going to Scott's house. He has a yard. Can I bring mittens? He pisses on everything. He's freaking out. No. No, you will not. We adopted Morty. We adopted a little black cat named Morty just because we were that hardcore into Rick and Morty. It was necessary. But he's so weird about affection, the way that he goes around people. We decided to give him a voice somewhere between Hank Venture and an adolescent Hank Hill. Because there are fruit bats, there are cats that love meat. Morty is a fruit cat. I don't understand this. Morty just gets the stare.
Excuse, I'd like to talk to you about that apple that you were eating. I'd like for you to just bring it down to me.
I can wave a tuna melt in his face. Fucking nothing. I bring out the apple.
You and I are going to be best friends. Can you just hand that down to me? Thank you so much.
He has eaten a peach out of my hand and run with it to the other side. We had my in-laws over last month, and we're cooking up dinner, and my mother-in-law brings out this pineapple, solid pineapple, not even like a cut-up fruity pineapple that you can smell and want to eat. This is really sweet. This is really nice fruit. I want to keep eating this. Just a solid, dusty porcupine potato. That's what's sitting basically on the stove. Some demented porcupine potato. We turn for 5 minutes, put stuff in the fridge. We look back. Morty is dragging the pineapple back under the Apple desktop that has not been used since 2004. With a look of just elation. Like a nostalgia critic fan finally meeting the son of a bitch for the first time. And I go to grab the pineapple. Morty here. He looks at me, puts two legs over the pineapple, begins humping the pineapple. And I say, enjoy your fruit. This is the circle of life right here. Morty took my peach away. We thought he was a black cat. We adopt black cats because we don't believe they're unlucky. We believe black cats are wonderful cats. Our last two cats were black cats. We found out Morty is a fucking lion cat. If you get a black and a white cat, they're called tuxedo cats because it looks like they're wearing a little tuxedo. It's so adorable. A reverse tuxedo, you know, splashes. Morty stood up to try and steal cherries from us. And we see this triangle of white. You are a Margaret Cho punchline in the making. Get down. You're not even a tuxedo cat. You are a banana hammock cat. You are lying. Go get your peach. Jesus Christ, you ran for that peach. So it's not even that I was picked on in high school. It's that all of my sisters married my bullies. All six of them. And they get to be in the house I grew up at for the holidays. And I realized that there was a point, like maybe 8 years ago, I tried to connect at some point with either Tyler, Taylan, Ryan, Brian. I don't fucking know their names, right? None of them have any necks. They all wear the same Penn State jersey. All right? Because they're wannabe LARPers. I don't know how else to put this. And he says,
yeah, I don't think I ever watched cartoons growing up.
There's a click in my head as I realized, I'm not talking to a human anymore. You're going up on the hated bully pedestal. What do you mean you never watched a cartoon? That's the point of being awake. What were you doing outside?
I was playing.
And I immediately thought, but the glare on the TV from the sun would destroy anything on the Sega Genesis. There's a reason Sonic and Tails played inside. Oh, he was doing sport. Ting. Is that the verb form? Is that the worst verb? I tried it once in junior high. They put me on the basketball team. I got kicked off the basketball team for cheating. They throw me the ball. I keep trying to enter the Konami code. We're going to get 100 more points. I got this, guys. I got this. Throw it. But you just gave it to me. Take this under the iMac and hump it for a half an hour.
It's my gift to you.
Take a moment on that bad boy. Thank you so much. Give it time. Give it time, and everything at MAGFest will become either a drinking game or a stripper game. When you become an adult, it just follows into your life. For example, strip Monopoly. Anytime you pass go, you must collect $200, but only in singles. Strip Battleship, where the cruiser's not the only thing going down. Strip Scrabble, where S&M gets you double points. Strip Candyland, sweet rewards, sour faces. Here's one specifically for you, MAGFest. Strip Settlers of Catan. Four chuckles, so I don't even need to do the sheep or the wool or the wood joke. Moving on. Strip Sorry Where Nobody Is. Strip Chess, which is not the first time a bishop has gotten me out of my pants. Let's talk! Last year, when I was able to be employed, had a coworker ask me what my sign was. I probably should have introduced myself. My name is Uncle Drunk. I'm a little yo right now. I'm going to rephrase that. I am enjoying MAGFest. Let's have a good time with that. She asked me, what's my sign? I told her the bat signal. Because she was too young to get a goddamn Thundercats reference. And millennial scum. We're looking forward to that with new pre-Emperor Palpatine all heading the white powerhouse, let's start calling it now. We're gonna have a fun time, kids. Oh, you comedians are gonna have such a great time in the next 4 years. It's gonna be like Bush Volume 2. That's why we're panicking, asshole! I don't necessarily look forward to throwing any more gasoline on that fire the same way that, like, city sanitation workers don't look forward to a weekend-long chili cook-off by the pier. Because we gotta clean it up and point people to this shit. This can't keep happening, you people! My father keeps coming out to these. This cannot happen! That was a bookend joke. I finally got that into a bookend joke. I'm so happy for that. Usually we talk about my father's butt, and that's the end of it. The thing is, a pun is just, it's a verbal fart. That's the joy of it. You get the same joy, same reaction. Everyone, and one person, ha, 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 ha. I've been keeping that in for an hour, you motherfuckers. And I'm not going to roll down the windows, click, because I am driving you. Same reaction, same buildup. I really like some of the dialogue that the younger kids are having. I just worry that as things get more complicated, I worry that, like, sexual identity, sexual orientation, gender identity, however it's going to be for youngins, it's going to be what Polish last names were for us. Someone just tells you what they are, and you go, where the hell is that from? What is that? What do you want to be called? Get on the bus. We have other things to worry about. I think eventually we're just going to erase anything off of the men's room and the ladies' room. We're not even going to call it the men's room and the ladies' room. We're just going to call it like literallys and well actuallys. I would love to think that as we get older, it's not going to be an issue of Nito King or Nito Queen. It's going to be more ditto. I saw that. I like that. I'm going to play that for a while. Does it fit me? Yeah. All right. Moving on. I think that would be the joy of it. I wanted to do something that brought me joy over the holiday season because we had such an issue with 2016. We even had passings within the immediate family, so everything seemed to pile on top of itself, and I didn't have any fruit to console me because fucking Morty took it all. But I did things that brought me love. I played Dark Souls 1 and 2. Let me rephrase. I failed miserably at Dark Souls 1 and 2 for an afternoon. Threw it away. So I went back to my other love of pro wrestling, and I realized there's shit that happens in pro wrestling that would never happen anywhere else, especially the way that they do up the fights. Pro wrestling is the only part where a good guy and a bad guy are going to punch each other. One's gonna take a punch and then take a nap. He's going to get up and give a punch and then take another nap. And they're just going to lie next to each other, kind of spooning, but kind of getting into the position for it. Let me do maybe not. Oh, the top rope. That is never going to happen anywhere else. I've never had a monster in Dark Souls go. You have people throwing Finn Balor potions and Estes. You got this, Finn! You got this! Ooh, your spine! Fragile little Irish nymph, we are so sorry.
So unfair, my favorite cosplayer.
Walked into a restaurant and the hostess said, oh, you're here for the assistant manager position. I said, just because I dress like I have no reason to live. I've worked a lot of restaurants, you idiots. It burns. I've worked breakfast shifts 7.5 years. You know what happens when you get up enough times before the sun goes up? Your body, after eons of evolution, says, what are you doing? Stay down. It is darkness. Predators are roaming the street. Because after 3 days in a row of opening, the longest I ever opened, 4:30 a.m., working until 3, 4 in the afternoon, 14 days in a row. On day 2, you start hearing voices. On day 4, you start listening to the voices. On day 5, you start compromising and trying to set up some kind of a night date because God forbid you have a social life and see anyone else outside of work. Hurt the people who make you do this with fire. All right, go on. What's your plan for this? Where are we going to get the gasoline? We open the door. You must walk through. I don't think you are right for this nervous breakdown we're setting up. All right, thank you very much. We'll call you please leave the head. Thank you. More maple syrup. Maple goddamn syrup is both slippery and sticky. So you can step on it, fall on your ass, and be stuck to the floor. While a four-year-old yuppie scum downloading things on the phone demanding his goddamn latte. Because with maple syrup, water doesn't wash it off. Soap doesn't wash it off. Hot water doesn't wash it off. Bleach doesn't wash it off. Because anything you touch with your syrup hand now just spreads equally sick. It's like goddamn monster blood. That's a Goosebumps reference. You're welcome, 90s kids. You're welcome, 90s kids. It just keeps spreading fucking... Because this is something that J.K. Rowling and Stephen King couldn't come up with. And you put it on your goddamn pancakes and you take it for granted. So I have to go back to work after MAGFest. This is why I'm so happy that this is my first show of the year. I've always wanted to come here. Trying for years. Noah brought up E3 earlier tonight. And I'm going to go back to it just ever so briefly. Because a couple of years ago, we all got lied to as the gaming community. We all got lied to our faces. Some Japanese guy, video game industry, came up and said, Pop, let's reference this season of South Park 2. Remember Mega Man? Remember when Mega Man was great? I love Mega Man 2! Oh man, remember Mega Man 2? I do! Don't remember anything after that until maybe Super or maybe X or maybe Zero comes along. Remember Mega Man? You give me all the money on Kickstarter. And I'm gonna make Mega Man great again! I'm gonna call it Mighty Number 9!
What happened to 1 through 8?
Fuck you, that's where I'll see you in 6 years! Mighty Number 9 sucked! And we all bought into it because we wanted a good Mega Man game other than Smash Brothers.
I love Smash Brothers because every 4 years, I get to add on to that joke.
I've been doing it since the damn N64. Should I also open up? I was very excited because, Noah, you were there for that too, and so were the Baldovins. Kat and I got married last year. That's about what it deserves. It's like three people were there. One guy goes, oh, shit, yeah, that. Oh. And my wife handled all the decorations because she's the graphic designer. Now, you should know we are a very strict household when it comes to shoes. As soon as you step in, you take off your shoes. You never put your shoes anywhere on or near the table because that's where food goes. That's where food goes. On all the picnic tables, we had these beautiful cut wooden medallions from a stump and moss. So we basically, to decorate the tables for our wedding, we went shopping for bush garbage. There's no other way to put this. We put tree stumps that probably grew in the ground where we don't want our feet to touch on the table where people ate. I paid a woman paper money for her dead tree. I paid processed dead tree for fresher dead tree, which is like paying for roadkill with a bucket of Slim Jims. And then my father, in between bowel movements, he cut up these inch-thick medallions, because we had 20 tables, these beautiful wooden medallions. And then my wife said, all right, we gotta clean these before they go on the table. And she put them in the dishwasher!
I just look for consistency in my life. But it was fantastic. Noah, what did I force the officiates to do first?
So since Noah and I, we do a lot of stuff with cosplay pro wrestling, we have a face-heel relationship for the most part, because we really do just rip off each other's jokes for the last 5 years, I think. We got all the potential pontificators, the comedians I know, the great public speakers who are, like me, the Universal Life Church, because I don't care who you are, if you love someone, I will marry your ass right then and there. I've done 2 Pokemon-themed weddings, I did a WWE-themed wedding, we did a League of Legends wedding last year at Pittsburgh, and it was a blast! No League of Legends, moving on. We got all the friends that we wanted up on stage. We forced them to play a game show where they answered trivia questions about ourselves. And then we had them go into the outdoor ball pit with a goddamn GoPro strapped to their heads. Because it's my special day, goddammit. And all I wanted, because originally it was going to be an inflatable obstacle course. We're gonna have our officiates in tuxes and dresses running through and climbing an inflatable obstacle course like goddamn Double Dare. Because I remember when Nickelodeon was fun.
I looked into what it would cost to buy a replica copy of the Shrine of the Silver Monkey. And we said we spent too much money on dead trees. Moving on. No Shrine of the Silver Monkey. They were run through. And I want it so bad. I want it for one of my sports brothers-in-laws to... How do I put this? I wanted him to lose. I know he wasn't participating, but I wanted him on camera to lose something. Why? Because we had an uneven number of people. My guy Jesse was going to run through last, and I had this idea. Because everyone is at this point where they're just popping out kids just to distract my mother, which is thank God, because Morty can't take any more Christmas trees because he's eaten and humped all of them. I wanted our last officiate to run through versus my 9-month-old niece. I know it says age 13 and up. I wanted him to lose because of his daughter, and I wanted him to feel that resentment toward her the rest of her life, so that when she eventually becomes a podcaster, journalist, creating, writing major, she'll have a focus spot. She won't spend 40 years looking for the source of it like David Sedaris. I'm not necessarily trying to help the next generation, just trying to make things more fun. Like many of you out there, we got the Fitbit. We got the Fitbit. Keeps track of all your steps. If you reach 10,000 steps a day, you get a dollar toward an Amazon gift card, but it stops at 10,000. Doesn't give you more for 11,000 or 12,000. And after walking around, I decided, well, let me strap it to my ankle. Oh, same difference. Let's just stand in front of Crunchyroll, Marathon JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, and just do this. It counts the number of steps. And for most of the men in this audience, you might recognize this motion. From age 13 until the day you goddamn die. If we had Fitbit technology when I was 13 years old and we just got AOL in the basement and I just discovered what La Blue Girl was, we would have bought the house by 17. We'd have a timeshare by this point. Christmas would be set. That's how you break an economy right there. On the only motion you knew to do by instinct. That was a bit weird. I feel good about it, though. Where do we end up going? After months of research, my wife, Kat, said, we've always wanted to go to this place. I grew up watching anime. For our honeymoon, we went to Tokyo. We went to Tokyo, we went to Japan, we went to Kyoto, we went down to Hong Kong, and I was excited to see Tokyo, but I hadn't realized what Tokyo exactly was. First off, in some cases, you need to understand. So we're going to talk about the Japanese. If there are any in the room, how did you get here? All right. We get to Tokyo, and you have to understand, Tokyo is full of massive streets, of bright, blinking buildings, and every different floor on every different building has a different running sign. It's bright, it's flashy. Sometimes it's a screen, sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's just a giant mechanical crab moving outside of it. It's like a pop-up ad, and a kid with ADD said, let's make a city go that way. I did not know that would exhaust me. It was insane how clean it was. And here's how they make it, how clean it is. First off, they don't even have a word for litter or garbage. You cannot do that. But any store you go to, anything you buy, even if it's a pack of tissues, they're going to put it in two plastic bags and give you three copies of the damn receipt. So they're turning me into a crazy bag lady, and I already have two cats living at home. Thanks, Japan. You're turning me into the crazy cat lady. Let's play with this now. The only place you can throw out your garbage is in your hotel room, which the trash can is this. Garbage comes but once a week. Because you've been shopping all day. You've got 8 versions of the damn receipt. And 4 bags for memorabilia, goddammit. We went to the Pokemon store in Tokyo. We got to the Pokemon store 2 hours before they opened up. So we screamed at the wall for 2 hours till the Pokemon store opened up. Because we're American, goddammit, manifest destiny. That's why Mega Man is the best American superhero of all time. You say he's from Japan? No, Mega Man's the best American superhero. Who else
but an American could break into some dude's house, murder all of his friends, walk out wearing his skin like a costume, say, I own this now, and get away with it. He wears blue, so he'd get away with it. It's a horrible joke. Where were we? Oh God, seizure heaven, Japan. My hotel had this shadow looming out just outside the window because we're right next to this massive movie theater multiplex and they have made a size replica of the shoulders and head of Godzilla. I woke up every morning to the frozen back sunlit face. Something I recognize. You're going nowhere. Is this the Bryan Cranston Godzilla? Because this is slow as fuck. Homeward Bound, The Hurt Locker. No one enjoyed that movie. Not even Cranston. And then on the roof, there was this beautiful hot tub. Now, living in Queens, New York means that's exactly the reaction that it deserves. If Godzilla truly attacked New York, it would be a very different movie. If he attacked New York and goddamn Ferris Bueller didn't fuck it up for everybody, he still wouldn't work. If Godzilla attacked Manhattan, he'd never be able to put his foot down, but he'd still get a fucking parking ticket for it. Why? Half of me is still in the damn water. If he attacked Queens, the white people would just jog faster. Godzilla would never attack the Bronx. The Bronx would attack Godzilla. His ass would be sashimi by the end of the damn night. Don't you lie to me. Godzilla attacking Brooklyn. Yeah, nice try. Brooklyn sees it as America and the rest of you are the United States of Brooklyn. Godzilla attacking Brooklyn. Who the fuck is this scaly mook? Boston send you because they can't beat us in baseball? Get the fuck out of here. Last borough, Staten Island. Godzilla would never attack Staten Island. No one would know. He's sitting there giving himself a pep talk, sitting there in the bay. All right, you got this. There's no Mecha Godzilla. We can do this. You got this. You got this. You're going to rise. All sort. This is your day. Your day. Have I been here before? Holy sheep shit. What happened here? You live here? The bridge is right there. Here's a 20. Take the fucking Verrazano to Hoboken. What is wrong? Why are you still here? Call me back when you got goddamn buildings. Man, that's ratchet, yo. Godzilla. Oh, right. I'm still stuck in Tokyo at this point. Okay. Public transit, crazy clean, crazy fun. There are these little people that stand off. They're dressed in these bright pink full body scrubs with little brush brooms and a guy in a big different colored scrub outfit, like a big, I think it was either blue or green colorblind, so it doesn't matter to me because all the subway lines are colored. And you thought Japan was a homogenous nation, didn't you? They wait for the train to stop and then just like little needle gnomes. They go in with their scrub brushes and they go in spraying everything and wiping everything down. You leave. It smells cleaner than anything that you will ever smell in the States. It's so clean. It's so organized. It's so lovely. And you get bogged down by so many damn receipts. It's not even they have to give you the receipt. They walk you over to the machine. There's a point in Kyoto, which is the real city you should all go to. Because you look out your window, 13th century beautiful Buddhist shrine, beautiful Shinto shrine, young schoolgirl getting chased by tentacle monster, but that's what you come to expect. So you come to expect. My wife needed some books from Japan. And since Amazon went from the drones to the flying skyship that they're working on right now, stop trying to be Skynet. Be the shield, Amazon. Be more like Nick Fury's shield, although now the helicopter bases would crash. So she gets the books mailed to this corner store. If you order anything to a store, what do? You bring your ID, you bring your smile, you bring your phone, you show them the receipt, show them the email. See the title of the books? See me? Give it to me now. I got weird. Okay. So old lady behind the cash register at the 7-Eleven, which is so much cooler in Japan. Full-on meal, and you still like yourself at the end of it. Because a 7-Eleven in America should have various catchphrases. 7-Eleven, burrito's a vegetable, right? 7-Eleven, make a great first date if you want her dead by the end of the night. 7-Eleven, if you had money, you'd be at Wawa. 7-Eleven, you'll be running to the bathroom before the end of this. 7-Eleven, an accidental vegan option, because you fucking know that chicken wing has no real meat in it whatsoever. 7-Eleven, what's lower, our prices or your self-esteem? 7-Eleven, no, we can't understand what you're saying either. We're in the 7-Eleven in Kyoto, and we have the receipt. We show the woman the receipt. She comes out from behind, and she walks us to this. I don't know if you guys are fans of the old Voltron or like the old anime. Everything was built like an Autobot workout for CrossFit, where you had to pull a dial. All the buttons were plastic and hollow and were lit underneath like a child's toy. No, that's top of the line in Japan, because everything's on their damn cell phones, but they fax everything in 3 hard copies. So they walk us over to, I guess, the Mega Thrusters or Go for Voltron. We don't speak Japanese. We can't translate through this. We give up after 10 minutes. We go back to our ryokan. We ask the woman behind the desk, we need you to handwrite a note for the lady at 7-Eleven. This is us. These are the books we want. Help us get these books, because they're sitting right behind the desk. And if I reached over and took them, they wouldn't know what to do because I didn't stamp anything. There's no jaywalking in Japan. There was a street this wide, half the stage, this wide, the entire street. No car, just the horizon. Teenage girl running from a tentacle monster. I'm not here to judge. But you have to wait for the blinky man. You can't jaywalk. You must wait for the blinky man. We're New Yorkers. We went. The old guy holding the stop sign, holding people across, turns and it became a JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. Oh, no! Reality is broken. We're all just beasts disguising behind flesh and clothing. We're going to the 7-Eleven, bye. We hand them the note. We hand the woman the note. Point. She goes, ah. She comes out from behind the desk, and she takes us by the hand. Thank God. And she points to the machine. Again. Thank God we had a friend that lived in Kyoto, came over, spent a half an hour playing with it, because then the machine printed out the receipt. He walked it over to the front desk. She stamped it, gave him a new receipt. He went back to the Mega Thruster, you know, the basic heart of the car is the fucking Omicron sphincter or whatever. Shoves that in, gets another receipt, second receipt, same machine, gets it stamped, gets the books. That is Japan. That is why their age of consent is still 13, because they're still stamping the goddamn paperwork from 1974. After Japan, we go to Hong Kong. I get to meet her father's side of the family. She gets to show off, look, I found a guy, we'll take that.
I have a podcast.
Which broke my heart, because I had some cousins that didn't show up to my wedding, and I understand, their dog passed away. It happens. They're old. You gotta keep the kids at home. Their dog passed away the month before our wedding, and they called it off because their purebred puppy was being airlifted from Madison, Wisconsin onto the golf course where my uncle plays golf. That is the single lamest, whitest sentence I could ever say that doesn't include the words latte, frisbee golf, or podcast. Showing it. But we get to Hong Kong, and you need to understand what Hong Kong is. It's a tropical island full of these giant mountains. And the Chinese said, all right, we're here. Fuck you, mountain. And the mountain said, oh, you're adorable. Oh, they're still here. To imagine Hong Kong, the hustle and the bustle, imagine streets as wide as the seat that you're in right now with people shoving and spitting through you. If you love shopping, if you love otherworldly cultures, if you love good food and dim sum, this is the place for you. If you want to stand in a position other than not your place, because Hong Kong is, imagine Chinatown. Yeah. And they have not only just a beautiful public transportation line, they not only have a subway line, they have what's called the ding ding, which I thought, because I'm hearing it through her mother's accent, because she speaks Cantonese sometimes with a thicker accent than other, the ding ding. So I think she's saying the ding ding, got it. No, it's this two-story, it's like the red bus from the Harry Potter movie, super narrow as fuck, but for 70 cents, it'll get you anywhere across the island. It's adorable, it's like the San Francisco treat here in the subtropics of Hong Kong. It's called, literally, Da Ding Ding, which I thought sounded racist because it's the only noise that thing could make. Isn't that where we got the whole phrase barbarian? Because the Greeks thought they're just saying bar, 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 bar. You know, like a bad George Bush impression. Bar. Just doing Dana Carvey's material. Who knew? I really had a great time, though. I was so happy to be brought into this new family. I'm so happy to eat new things. And our last night, her cousin says, I'm going to buy you guys a massage. It's your honeymoon. You're going for a massage. Y'all have an idea of what a massage is, right? Someone puts their hand on you, kind of do this, and you feel good. I have people who make livings as massages. I just got into touch with someone I went to elementary school with, found me through my podcast over the years. She makes 6 digits a year doing massage therapy. Reiki massage therapy. Reiki is the massage therapy where you put your hands on the person and that's it. You don't move them. You realign their chakras, whatever it is. You put your hands on someone and that's it. But she doesn't massage people. Do you want to take a guess what she massages? Horses. 6 digits a year going up to a horse and living every brony's fantasy. Your anahata is so clenched, Buttercup. Are you feeling depressed? 58 grand now. We go for a Hong Kong massage. So we're both sitting there. We both get on the table, and both our ladies come in. They say, "Do you want pressure point, which can hurt, or do you want aromatherapy?" We gotta walk up hills tomorrow. Aromatherapy.
I'm expecting like some nice penis butter, you know, just some soft slapping going on.
The woman's hand leaves my back, and I suddenly feel her, I guess like taking her fist and just going, boom, into my asshole, kneading my butt cheek like it's fucking bread. And she's not using her hand. I look up to say, what are you doing? I see. As she puts my face back down with her other foot and continues to knead me as I'm crying in pain. I look over to my wife. This was a horrible idea. We didn't get the pressure point, did we? I don't think they know the difference. She then gets off me and she picks up my leg. I've been on my feet the last 2 weeks walking around Asia. Picks up my feet. Very tight, very tight. Bam, bam. I know it's very tight. I've been walking on it for 2 weeks. Why are you mean to me? She then starts talking and cackling, not laughing. I know what people make. I sometimes do this for a living, but she cackles the way my sister and mother cackle. Like Eddie Vedder holding a note. Very fine, I'm better good. All right, good boy, you have a blast with that one. Words! You got mistaken for a human. I understand how it goes, Eddie. Get off the damn stage. Get out of the joke. Let's get out of this. Let's get out of my ass and my... All right. Because I'll inherit it from a father eventually. She rolls me around and starts slapping me. I know this cannot be part of a massage. She's telling my wife, look how fat this is. I can't reach this. Look how fat this is. I can't reach. Let's recap. She's shoved her foot in my ass, punched me, and is now slapping me, calling me fat. I thought I escaped this in high school. If I wanted this, I would have gone home for the holidays because my sisters married all of the bullies who did this to me in middle school, and we've paid this woman money for this shit. They leave the room at one point laughing. Look at my wife. Is it done? They didn't say, like, thank you, goodbye. No, they just left the room. They're like, what do? We have to sit up. I can't sit up. Everything hurts. You have to go. Go get your parents or the police. Whatever you can do. And then they come back in the room. We start crying again. No! Turns out, they didn't work for the massage parlor. Because her cousin knows the owner of the massage parlor. Like, handed everyone tips as we left. Yeah, I come here like 2 or 3 times a week. They just do my feet. All right, Colossus, what are you, Wolverining this out? What do they do with that? Just stab you with a screwdriver? What is that pain? Just hands the money, starts talking to the owner, starts talking to the, points to the two women in the corner.
get in the car, get in the car, get in the car. I have to sort this out. I have to sort this out. That's how my honeymoon wrapped up. In pain. And I had the flu on the flight back, so it was joyous. Like, I got to watch this new beautiful film that stars Jackie Chan and Johnny Knoxville. Because Chris Tucker is too busy to do a stupid movie with Jackie Chan where there aren't even stunts. So back to video games. It's our safe space, kids. Most of you know what you're gonna get when it comes to a Super Mario game. It's mainly for kids, it's gonna be bright, it's gonna be colorful. It's gonna be fun for everyone. They just build in a new mechanic every time. We've been playing Mario since NES. Who had the original Super Mario? Mario 2, Mario 3. We're friends now. If you were a fan, you would have brought Uncle Yo some beer. Moving on. And they finally admitted that they ran out of ideas. Japan admitted, Nintendo admitted they ran out of ideas. So along came Mario Maker. It's been a year. Are you making a new Mario game?
No, you're making a new Mario game. You're just paying us to make it.
This is the stupidest fucking internship I ever heard of. So let me get this straight. I'm gonna pay you for games that I already have and have had for 30 years. Make the game and then have my friends run through it so they fail and hate me. You said $60? You said 60. Is there any DLC for that? That would be fantastic. Because they gave up. Like, they finally caved in and gave us a female character in the Legend of Zelda games. Some of us grew up, we thought, oh, maybe Zelda is the little boy, girl, Tinkerbell without his wings running around in a little kilt. Maybe. No. Because they came up with this new idea. Let's have a girl character people can run through. Let's make a girl Link. Because if only the Legend of Zelda series had a girl who's in every Zelda game, who might even be the name of the franchise for 30 goddamn years. Nope, make a brand new character. All right, what is this character? It's gonna be an elf. That's original. It's gonna wear a green skirt. I'm sensing a problem here. What's her name gonna be? Link. No, have that already. Girl. No, Link. Girl. Linkle. Link. Girl. Link. Girl. Yeah. Because 2015 was the year Nintendo finally did a Google search for Legend of Zelda cosplay, Legend of Zelda fan fiction, or asked any dwarf from any fantasy world. He's riding bareback on a horse. He's wearing a skirt. Oh, yeah, he's a little bitch. A Link cosplayer is just a Tinkerbell who hasn't earned her wings yet. It's a little too late, Nintendo. It's too little too late. It's like getting fisted by Tinkerbell. The enthusiasm's there, honey, but we both know this is not working. I've had a Chinese woman's foot in my ass. I bookended that. That's the second time a butt has been a nice end piece. As it jiggles. So we got a little bit of time for a wrap up, which is pretty nice. We have issues coming together as people because we're so busy worrying about semantics and splitting hairs. We need to start labeling things in a way that everyone can get behind. That's how they'll sell things to you, is a euphemism, is lying to you. Which is why global warming failed, because there was still some snow and some ice. Climate change, too vague. We need to name this global catastrophe after something that everybody wants to stop. No one wants to hear about it anymore, and they'll do anything to stop it and burn it alive in its tracks. I say we rebrand climate change to be called Bill Cosby's boner. Every year, Bill Cosby's boner can be felt across the Midwest, drying up California at the mention of it. Bill Cosby's boner is displacing millions of Syrian refugees every year. Flowers are blooming twice, confused because of Bill Cosby's boner. No one knows when Christmas comes along because Bill Cosby's boner is ruining it. Gone away is the bluebird. Here to stay is a new bird and the bluebird. None of them really left. Now they're fighting over competition. Fuck you, Bill Cosby's boner. You're taking away polar bear homes. And Coca-Cola will have their vengeance. Or they'll just make new fucking mascots. I know they don't care. Yeah, me too. I'm not sure what they were yelling at, but it was a good time. There have not been enough Pokemon jokes on the stage.
Based on that reaction, there won't be. All right, let's move on. Pokemon, go home, you're drunk. I was just tired of receiving all these unsolicited Diglett pics. We were all thinking it. We were all playing it. You put a drowsy on the bed. She's, nah. I shouldn't say that having just wrapped up a Bill Cosby bit. I apologize. With Pokemon, you can teach almost anything to kids. You can teach them probability. You can teach them teamwork. But also, you can teach them a little bit about blood sporting because Pokemon is so efficient. It combines everything we love about two countries, everything we love about Japan, and everything we love about Mexico. Adorable animals, a collecting game, cockfighting. That is efficient as hell, but you can teach them probability. If I throw this, then he'll do this. Then you have to start working game theory. And Pokemon can also teach you...
Let's try that again. Pokemon! That was strange.
Pokemon can also teach you about polyamory, having multiple lovers, because it teaches you how to have that talk. Look, baby, you are my starter. I've had you from the beginning. But you know, sometimes I need to play with fire, or I need fire to play with me. I'm always gonna come back to you because Uber is expensive. And you understand, I got you, and then one in every part, I got an Elite Four team. Sometimes I just wanna roll over and take a chance on a Wigglytuff. Sometimes I wanna get money with a Mudkip. Sometimes only a Geodude can get my rocks off. You stay there, babe, because you're my starting type. I'm always coming back for your Vine Whips. And then you frisky little kids who we met on Thrender, which is the Tinder for people looking for their anonymous third in a menage a trois, I've heard. There's Tinder, there's Grindr, there's Thrender, which doesn't end you with a new friend necessarily, and Furder. There is a Tinder for furries. And I wish I were making that up. It's $2.99. I've read.
Sometimes you take a chancy on a Mudkip.
I'm gonna wrap it up here because do you guys want to yell butt stuff?
Yeah.
My favorite reality TV show. A couple years ago, we watched it now on YouTube. It's called The Great British Bake Off. All right. Great British Bake Off is a reality show. It's an elimination show. And they have these two older judges, which I love. There's this silver-haired fox with these striking blue Daniel Craig eyes who wears tight pants and approaches every table.
What are you making the day, Mudge?
It's like a JoJo's Bizarre Adventure every time. Tell me about those cinnamon buns. And then they've got this adorable, tiny, dried-out scarecrow named Mary Berry, who's been a BBC cooking icon for generations. Multiple generations. I think she's been on BBC longer than Doctor Who in its entirety. I think she may just be one step away from regenerating. But all of their phrases, when they critique the baked goods, can be followed perfectly with the phrase, like a butt. And now it's time for the participation scene, kids. The problem is, when I hand you the microphone, you guys are gonna yell, like a butt. You're good. Don't back into this, take your time with this. All right, well, there'll be a nice tail end to it. When you cut into it, it should hold its shape very well.
Like a butt!
You have to warm it with your hands first. It has to be stiff enough to shape and firm enough to hold the juices once it's been cooked. It's wetter than normal. Doesn't feel as firm as when you tried it at home.
Like a butt.
The filling's completely dried out. It's not a delight to eat.
Like a butt.
Oh, darling, I would have liked to have seen fewer chocolate chips.
Like a butt.
We're friends now. And I hope you guys can deal with this. So it has been, by the way, a pleasure to just watch a bunch of comedians come up here and just talk about gaming, just talk about coming out here. This is the best way to start your new year as a distraction. I hope you meet a stranger, play a game with them, and enjoy it. I hope you guys play something that brings you joy, something from your childhood. I hope you walk out with more friends than you entered in. I hope you keep coming back to MAGFest. because there's no other way for me to thank an audience that's been supporting me for 7-8 years, because this is the start of my final year in the con circuit. You know, sometimes a schoolgirl outgrows her uniform. Sometimes the doctor has to be recast. The show goes on no matter what. But I wanted to thank you guys and give you my final love and send off to it. Same way I do everything, with a goddamn rhyming couplet poem. Dr. Seuss fetish. Seuster is an app that gets you hooked up with, all right. Sneeches and their beaches. I'm glad that you made it out to the con. I'm glad we shared laughs and we're carrying on. We're free to be nerds. So that implies us to talk about stories and the games that inspire us. So we learn a new game. It's me versus you, and we've had some losses and a couple wins too. Whatever the dice roll, I'm just happy to play. I'm happy to see you, and I'm happy to say, game on, my friends, game on. If you like tapping buttons, if you're that kind of a fan, or if you do card games, keep tapping for mana, always... All right, just making sure that the magic is officially gathered. It's been long enough. It's been gathered the last 30 years. Always make space at the gaming table. Always help newbies feel welcomed if you're able. Be the pathfinder you want to see in the world. Reach out to every lost boy and hopeless fangirls. Game on, my friends. Game on. So by the power of Grayskull, may the force be with you. Catch them all, go fast, and have your pops too. Moon Prism power, Thundercats ho. Keep looking up, Boomer lives, enjoy your burrito. Avengers assemble, flame on, Excelsior, sweet Christmas, Hulk smash. Live long and prosper. Don't be a dick, to thine own self be true. Evildoers beware, they can't take the sky from you. 1 minute to win, round 3, fight, game over. Continue, reload, it's gonna be all right. Game on, my friends. Game on. Thank you guys so much for making it out to the first ever Mag Laughs. I hope it's the first of many as the tradition goes on. Have an amazing fucking night. I'm getting in line for the goddamn proto, man. I hope you join me for that. Yeah. Give it up for Noah, for Will, for all of our comedians tonight. My name's Uncle Yo. I gotta go, guys. Live, laugh. Stop putting your foot in my ass. Good night, guys.
Guys, thank you so much for coming. How many of you psychos were here from the beginning? A couple of you. Thank you guys so much for being here. Give it up for everyone that was on stage. Be sure to check out all the things that we talked about. Check out Uncle Yo. Check out Plus Two Comedy. Check out the Laugh Finder podcast. Check out SamAndBillAreHuge.com. Yeah, SamAndBillAreHuge.com. Guys, this room is now an open space. So if you guys wanted to come up here and talk and do comedy, you're now welcome to. I'm going to leave. I've been doing this for 5 hours now. Yeah, sure. Yeah, let's keep it going. Now, thank you guys so much. My name's Noah Land from Plus Two Comedy. Have a wonderful evening.